Okay, so this is going to be the very first lecture segment in my microeconomics and my macroeconomics class. And what we're going to do first is talk about some of the ways that economists look at the world. And one way of looking at economics is that it's the study of the production, distribution, and consumption of resources. That's a famous definition. Another is sort of, it's a way of thinking about the world and analyzing the choices people make. And what I'm going to do here is, most introductory economics textbooks have some sort of big ideas or ideas for after the final exam or fundamental principles that they lay out in the first chapter. And so I've taken four different textbooks. They're all pretty commonly used. Mankiw, Krugman, Baumol and Blinder, Cohen and Tabarrok are all pretty common. Baumol and Blinder is a little bit of an older textbook, but still in current editions. Cohen and Tabarrok is a little bit of a newer or younger textbook. There are also sort of some political differences here, but you can see that there are a lot of commonalities in how economists look at the world, regardless of whether or not they're young or old, or sort of on the left or on the right here. So one of the most fundamental things that economists think about here is economists think a lot about the idea of scarcity. And so because resources are scarce, we have limited time, we have limited natural resources, we have limited attention spans, we have limited bandwidth. Because of that, because resources of all different types are scarce, not just natural resources, that means people face trade-offs. And so you can see that sort of three out of these four authors regard that as a really important thing to think about here. Another thing is, people often think economics is about money. But economists like to sort of get away from the idea of money as much as possible, because money is really a way of sort of counting and keeping track. But fundamentally, it's the real goods and services that economists like to concentrate on. And so you can see here that economists, sort of three out of these four here, say, okay, we need to go ahead and get people to think about costs in a different way. So the cost here that we're talking about here is the idea of the opportunity cost of something. So economists like to measure opportunity costs rather than costs in money. And so one way of looking at this, say for instance, would be, suppose you have a new video game out there and it costs $40. If you make $8 an hour, then you're going to have to work for 5 hours to afford that video game that costs $40. So you can see that that's really the fundamental way to think about the cost of it. Yes, there's the money, but even more importantly, there's what you gave up to get it. That could be your labor, or it could be that if you spent the $40 on the video game, then you didn't go take your significant other out to eat, and that would have also cost $40. So different ways of thinking about what it costs to obtain a good or service. Often the monetary cost is not the most interesting way to look at it. The other idea here is the idea of implicit costs. So you might look at the cost of taking a introductory course in economics, and you might go, well, you know, I have some fees for the units and I have the textbook, but the biggest cost is almost surely the cost of your time. So if you think about the amount of schoolwork you might put in, you might go, well, I'm going to take this class for 15 or 16 weeks, and maybe I'm going to work an average of, say, 10 hours a week just to make the math easy. So I'm going to work 150 hours on this stuff. And then maybe if I, again, value my time at $8 an hour, because I otherwise could have been working for a wage, then we have 150 hours times $8 an hour. So the time cost of taking the class would be $1,200. And really, you can see, even though textbooks are really expensive, and even though, you know, tuition is always going up, it's really the time cost of education that is the major expense. Another way that economists like to look at things is economists are really interested in the idea of what we call marginal analysis. So marginal analysis is how do we make the optimal decision by doing a little bit more or a little bit less of something. And you can see all four of the authors have concentrated on this as something that you should learn in an introductory economics class. This is most relevant in microeconomics, but it also occurs in macroeconomics as well. Another way of looking at this is whenever we're making a decision or analyzing something, it should always be relative to what? So almost no costs exist in a baseline. So really these two are closely related. The idea of how we measure a cost is compared to what we gave up to get it, and the idea that we should sort of look at the correct value of something being a little bit more or a little bit less. And in a microeconomics class in particular, we'll go into this very heavily here. Then finally here, you can see that three out of the four authors have decided it's important to point out that people respond to incentives. And incentives could be purely economic, they could be purely monetary, or they could be something like social status, or it could be leisure, or something like that. And so economists think that people respond to these things. Some incentives are external, like all of the ones I just mentioned, but sometimes incentives are internal as well. So it could be the pride in a job well done or something like that. So economists generally think that people respond to incentives. That's not the same thing as saying that people are only motivated by money. So again, people could respond to external social incentives, or they could respond to internal incentives as well. I think what I would say is, if you change the incentives, you'll change people's behavior a little bit. That would be how I would prefer to rephrase this. And we'll go ahead and make that the end of the first video segment.